Hi folk, welcome to the live stream. We're going to be starting in a couple of minutes, so finish getting your teas and your coffees together, gathering the family. We're going to continue tinkling and just gathering ourselves, and then we'll start officially in a couple of minutes.
Barry's watching.
Wellington. It's lovely to have you with us. There's five of us you can see here in the building, with Liam looking after our sound system for us behind the camera. I'm not quite sure how many of you out there are there. I can see 52 according to my stream here are watching, so hopefully that'll go up. We're hoping to make this as interactive as possible, so we're going to go through the service, lead people through it. But if you want to comment, you're very welcome to do that, and there will be times in the service when we'll ask you specifically to comment, particularly when it comes to prayer time, so we can be praying with and for each other. So we are experimenting with this, so do feedback and let us know what works for you, what doesn't, what you'd like to see better. We aren't able to broadcast the song words, but the list of songs is available further down on the Facebook page if you want to Google them and join in. So, we're going to begin by praising God in song, with the song's praise is rising, and God's love is big.
Oh,
sure that Nick and Caroline were giving their all to the actions. I'm very disappointed. Maybe we ought to make them do it again at the end. But it just reminds us, in the middle of all these things, I was just thinking as we were singing there, that we welcome you here, Lord Jesus, and we welcome Jesus here, but actually we don't have to be in church. We can welcome Jesus wherever we are, into our living rooms, our homes, places we work. And we're continuing our Life on the Frontline series this morning, and we're thinking about what it means to invite Jesus here, wherever here is for us. And that reminder that God's love is so big, even when life is tough, which is for some at the moment, and life is being disrupted. We can trust the God who made the universe, who loves us and has a plan for us. So we're going to be thinking about a bit more about that this morning. Caroline is going to read our Bible reading for us. If you'd like to look it up, it's in Colossians. Maybe Caroline might tell us where in Colossians it is.
It's Colossians 3, and it's about there in the Bible. Really near the Bible. It's only a little book, so it's quite tricky to find, but it will be there. Colossians 3, 12 to 17. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you, and over all these virtues put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you were called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom through psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And I feel like saying, and take a tissue, because it's a bit like something your mum would say, isn't it?
Was that your best mum voice?
That was my best mum.
That was your best mum voice. It is, of course, this morning, Mel and Loving Sunday. And if we were all gathered together, Sheila and Elsie and the others would have prepared bunches of daffodils for us to be giving out to each other, which unfortunately we can't do this year, which is really sad. But we did want to just take a moment to think about Mothering Sunday, particularly for those of us who aren't able to get to see our mums when we normally would, and just recognise that that's a bit difficult for some of us, but some of us do have our mums around, and we can spend some time with them and celebrating with them. So we're going to say a prayer now. Prayers for Mothering Sunday. Lord, we thank you for the women you've put in our lives who care for us, for mothers and carers of every type, aunties, grandmothers, and the many women who help raise us. Where we miss them, may you comfort us. As we pray for each other, we recognise that sometimes mothers are not perfect like you are. Where we are hurt, may you restore us. We pray for those who are part of caring for children in all sorts of different ways, for teachers and those in education, social workers and support workers, youth and children's leaders, nurses, doctors, therapists, and all those in healthcare. Fill them with the fruit of your Spirit and equip them for the work you've set before them. We pray for children who are not currently with the mother figure or parents they need, or are facing uncertainty and instability. Would you pour out your love, comfort, and peace on them? In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing again, and we're going to sing of the living hope that we have in Jesus, even when things are difficult. thank you that you are our living hope in the face of sickness, and even in the face of death, we know that your life calls us forward into life with you forever. Thank you for your victory over death. Amen. So, as I said a little bit earlier, we're continuing the series that we've been doing in all in looking at life on our front line and what it means to live our faith on the front line. Some of you may remember the coffee mats we had in the first week, where we had lots of doctors all going out. We took these coffee mats into different places where I suspect they sat on desks and in different places we're not allowed to go now. It helped us to remember that we're on our front line out there. We did the big map, you probably can't quite see it on the screens, with all the dots on it, all the places around Telford and beyond, where we all go and live out our lives Monday to Saturday. As we think about life on our front line, with the change that's been happening in the last couple of weeks, it brings new challenges. But we're continuing to realise that whatever we do, however small it is, wherever our front line changes, we can be significant for God. Of things perhaps that symbolise my front line, my weekly life, my Bible. I spend quite a lot of my time in my study, reading my Bible, preparing sermons, Bible studies, that kind of thing. More and more now, my laptop and my phone, because I'm doing lots of phone contact with people, lots of telephone contact, trying to stay in touch with people. That kind of symbolises my front line. And also on there, of course, is my diary. And no day for me is the same. To talk to lots of people about Jesus in lots of different places. So, what we're going to do is we're going to think about what is our front line, what might symbolise our front line, and we're going to lay them down I'm going to lay mine down at the bottom of the cross. I'm going to put the Bible down to my side, but I can't put my phone down because I'm trying to work out how I can see your comments. At the moment, I can see the live stream. There's 123 people watching according to this, which is great. But for some reason, I'm not getting comments coming off of my phone, which is... You've got a few, have you, Lucy?
Just a few.
Okay. Well, you might have to tell me what they are, because they're not coming off on my phone. And this next bit's actually interactive. It's not going to work if I can't see the comments. So, I've got about 10 here with me. Are they coming up on there? Liam says they're coming up on that phone as well. It's just obviously my phone can't cope with it. There you go. So, what I'd love for you to do at home... we're going to have another song in a minute, so you've got, it's quite a long song, so you've got a little bit of time to do this, is to find something that symbolises your front line. If you go to nursery, it might be your nursery bag. If you go to school, it might be your school books, somewhere you go to work, something that symbolises where you go to work, or where you spend Monday, Friday, normally, not this week. Or if you can't find something, you might find a bit of paper and write it down, and perhaps put it down in front of the TV or whatever you're watching this on, to just put it down and give it, symbolically give it to God. Just like I've laid this one out at the face of, bottom of the cross, foot of the cross, to give it to God. Something you might want to give to God. And if you could comment on the video stream as to what it is, then other people can see what your front line is. We'll be praying for you into that, and we'll use it in our prayers later as well. So go and find something, write something down, lay it down, and put it in the comment stream. So other people can be praying for you on your front line, and we can pray for you later when we do our prayers. So as we do that, we are going to sing Oceans. So, over to Nick to share some thoughts with us.
Okay. Well, before we do, let's just pray. Lord, just thank you for your word. And thank you that you speak to us today through your word. Lord, will you give us the ears to hear what you have to say to us this morning, and hearts soft enough to be transformed by your word. Amen. So, it's been an interesting week. I mean, just a few days ago, I never would have imagined that we'd be right here at this time on a Sunday morning, just facing an empty building and speaking to a camera. But we're certainly living in very uncertain times, unpredictable times, and they're just so fast changing, and it's just scary. And that's how the world was being described before the coronavirus. And churches across the world, they're closing their doors to help protect others. And when you think about it, it's really ironic. I mean, we usually feel like we've got to fight to keep the doors open as long as possible so that others might be saved. And we're usually just desperate for people to walk through our doors. But here we are. And I'm actually quite thankful for this. I'm not thankful at all for what the world is going through, but I'm thankful that the churches are closing their doors. Because we as Christians, as churchgoers, we have an opportunity to differentiate between being the Christian that goes to church and being the church. Because going to church is no longer an option. And the situation that we find ourselves in today, it's not entirely unique. Humans have suffered through pandemics before. The church has navigated through pandemics before. And in fact, the church has actually done quite well in times like this. Because part of the reason for the early church's explosive growth was because of how we responded in times of need, and times like we're experiencing today. Nearly a quarter of the Roman Empire was wiped out in the 2nd century during the Antonine Plague. And again in the 3rd century, the plague of Cyprian nearly wiped out all the manpower needed for food production. And their army, the Roman army, was just left just severely weakened. But it was through those times that the Roman Empire started to take notice of the lowly Christians. Because the Christians served and cared for the sick and the needy, and many times losing their own lives as a result. But many throughout the Roman Empire saw the courage and selflessness that these Christians had, and several decided to follow Jesus because of it. Christianity was growing so fast in these times that the emperor, Julian, grew desperate to put a stop to Christianity. Julian attempted to establish charities that would serve the needy, the sick, and the poor as well or better than the Christians did. And Julian, he wrote a letter. It was in 362, and it says, "It was a disgrace that these impious Galileans, these Christians, support not only their own poor, but ours as well." But his attempt to stop Christianity, it failed miserably. Christianity just grew stronger, especially through the times of struggle. And sociologist and church historian Rodney Stark, he estimates that the death rates of people where Christian communities were present were cut nearly in half during these times, because they didn't flee from the sick out of their own interest and just left them to die. But what drove the early church to just live like this? And why did the Emperor Julian's attempt to replicate this way of living amongst his own people just fail? Well, again, Rodney Stark, I recommend his books. From his book, The Rise of Christianity, he says, like Julian, his attempt failed because there were no doctrinal bases or traditional practices for them to build upon. And just because the emperor says, be nicer and less selfish to people like the Christians are, it didn't motivate people to put their lives on the line. I don't care how powerful a person is. If he's asking me to be willing to die for a stranger, I'm not going to do it just because he's asking me to. Especially if he's not even willing to do that himself. But the Christians had different motivations. They were motivated by the teachings of Jesus. Like when he said, "I was hungry and you fed me. I was thirsty and you gave me a drink. I was homeless and you gave me a room. I was shivering and you gave me clothes. I was sick and you stopped to visit. I was in prison and you came to me. I'm telling the solemn truth. Whenever you did one of these things to someone overlooked or ignored, that was me. You did it to me." For Christians, they cared for the sick and the dying. When they were doing that, they were serving Jesus. But it's much more than this. Because unlike Julian, Jesus didn't command others to do what he wasn't prepared to do himself. Jesus came to endure our suffering, experience and know our suffering. And he took on our suffering so that we might experience life, his life, with him. That's what motivated Christians in the pandemics of the past. Their God was not only a God that taught them to value others above themselves, but their God was a God that practiced what he preached. It's Jesus, God in the flesh, came to live amongst us in our suffering and was willing to die for us so that we might live. I like the Message version of Colossians reading that Caroline had read earlier. It just says, "So, let the peace of Christ keep you in tune with each other, in step with each other. None of this going off and doing your own thing. Let every detail in your lives, words, actions, whatever, be done in the name of the Master Jesus, thanking God the Father every step of the way." Jesus also said, "There's no greater love than this, being willing to lay down your life for a friend." There's just something noble and just heroic and attractive about these early church stories where they refused to leave their neighbor's side, even when it meant their own death. But I'd like to just share one more story of how Christians responded in times like this. In 1527, the bubonic plague broke out, and Martin Luther was one of those Christians that refused to leave the city, and instead he cared for the sick. But his daughter died as a result. And later on, he wrote a letter to the Christians instructing them, and there's a large focus on the fifth commandment of "Thou shalt not murder." And in this letter, he states that we must never endanger others through our negligence and recklessness. And he goes on to encourage the Christians to obey quarantine orders when they are given. Avoid spreading the sickness. So according to Luther, if you fail to do this and you inadvertently spread the disease, no matter our motivations or our intentions, if our carelessness leads to death, it's the same as committing murder. And Luther carried that weight of what happened to his daughter until his death. Laying down your life for a friend and loving your neighbor as yourself doesn't have to be a heroic or courageous act. Sometimes, in times like this, the best way we can love our neighbor is by staying away. Yeah, be ready and available when we're needed. But we've been called to live sacrificially. And right now, that might just mean staying put. And as much as we're going to want to get out and live our lives like normal again, it's reckless and it's careless and it's going to take lives away. And don't stockpile, leaving the shells bare for your neighbors wanting. What did our reading say this morning? Let the peace of Christ keep you in tune with each other. And step with each other. None of this going off and doing your own thing. Live sacrificially. Live as people of faith. If God can make manna fall from heavens in the wilderness, we're not going to starve. I don't know what the Bible says about loo rolls. See, I didn't think this through. Next week we have to have canned laughter like a sitcom. Because this place would be roaring. But we're just getting started with this. And it's already hard. This past week's already been hard. And it's going to get harder. But we were made for times like this. We were called for this. Through Jesus, we're following a God that doesn't back away from suffering. And we're following a Savior that sacrificed everything so that we might experience life at its fullest. And it's moments like this. If we follow Jesus, live like him, the world will find hope. And they'll experience the love that he has for them. So Lord Jesus, thank you for this calling, especially in times like this. Will you give us the courage and the strength to follow you in this calling? Amen.
Thanks, Nick. Now, we are going to have a bit of time for prayer now. We're not going to be able to pray for everybody's comments. There are loads on here. But Caroline and I are just going to probably pick three or four, and not name names, but just out some of the themes perhaps pray for us as we live on our front lines and as we try and put into practice what Nick's been saying to us today about being courageous. Is that okay? Okay. Well, that's done.
Yeah.
All right, we'll see how this works. Father God, I thank you for all those who have responsibilities for looking out for other people and staying in touch with them by telephone and email and Skype and all those other ways of staying in touch. Thank you for that gift of conversations with people who are isolated and lonely. I pray your protection on them and those conversations will bring life and hope. In Jesus' name, amen.
Lord Jesus, we just pray for those in, especially in the pharmacies, giving out drugs, and maybe even rationing drugs in days to come. Lord Jesus, we give them your peace and your wisdom, and a real sense of your calm flowing over them today. Lord Jesus, let them know that you are in it. You have a plan, and it's bigger than anything we can dream of. Help them to look to you, to stay with you, to stay close to you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
And Father, we pray for all those who work in education, who are having to get used to very different requirements, more childcare than teaching, and what teaching is going to look like. Senior leadership teams in schools, trying to reconfigure things for staff as they some work from home and some go in. You would give them patience, endurance, insight and grace. We pray for youngsters who are at home unexpectedly, for parents who are looking after them and carers who are looking after them. It would help them have patience with each other and that we spend so much time together, and that this would be a time of forming good, loving relationships. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. We pray for those at home, maybe not able to get out on a normal basis, and what this isolation is going to be like for them. They may feel even more isolated. Lord, we just pray that you'll come close to them. Pray that your spirit would fall in their rooms, their homes, in their lives. Today, carry them through this time. Jesus, amen.
And we pray for all those working in different areas of healthcare, in our hospitals, our GP surgeries. Pray for midwives, for all those who are preparing for the forecast upon surge of cases.
just lift up all those people with jobs that are looking uncertain right now. Maybe a time of being laid off or maybe losing their jobs. Lord, this is really a crisis time and we really don't know where to turn. We just look to you, Lord. We just pray that the government will have plans, will have backup plans, and we pray that those who are risking maybe a drop in income or no income, Lord, that you will step in that gap. We pray for the people who manage the food banks and other places that we can remember to help serve them, but also that you will surround them, give them your peace.
Lord Jesus Christ, we ask you to protect us from the spread of this coronavirus.
Mm.
You are powerful and merciful.
Mm.
And this is our prayer. Yahweh Shalom, Lord of peace. We remember those living in coronavirus hotspots, those currently in isolation. May they know your presence in their isolation, your peace in their turmoil, and your patience in their waiting. Prince of Peace, you are powerful and merciful. Let this be our prayer. May your mercy come quickly to meet us, for we are in desperate need. Help us, God, our Saviour, for the glory of your name. And we are going to join together in our family prayer, in the Lord's Prayer. And I'm going to read it a phrase at a time, and the folk here are going to repeat it after me. If you'd like to repeat it after me at home as well, to join in this prayer together. Our Father in heaven.
Our Father in heaven.
Hallowed be your name.
Hallowed be your name.
Your kingdom come.
Your kingdom come.
Your will be done.
Your will be done.
On earth as in heaven.
On earth as in heaven.
Give us today our daily bread.
Give us today our daily bread.
Forgive us our sins.
Forgive us our sins.
As we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation.
Lead us not into temptation.
But deliver us from evil.
But deliver us from evil.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory.
Are yours now and forever.
Are yours now and forever.
Amen. Excellent. We're going to sing our final song of worship here this morning, which is Sings of the Goodness of God. And we sing that with every breath that we are able, we're going to sing of the goodness of God. And I know that this one of those things with this coronavirus is it takes people's breath away, it makes it difficult to breathe. So let's sing this on behalf of all those who are struggling to breathe this morning, that they will come to know the goodness of God.
Thank you.
Christ, who appeared to your disciples when the doors were shut, appear unto all those in the world today who live their lives behind closed doors. And the blessing of God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. So that's the end of our worship this morning. It's been really good to have you with us. Before you go, I do have a couple of notices. I thought I'd do them here. Continue to follow up on Facebook. We'll communicate as much as possible about what's happening in and around the church. We haven't printed off copies of the notices, but we are emailing them out to our notices distribution list. If you haven't received a copy of the notices by email and you would like to, please don't put it on the comments here, because that means I'd have to trawl all the way through the comments. But if you could email the office@allsaints-wellington.org and say you'd like to receive the notices, we can send those out to you. Today, the archbishops have called for a day of prayer around the country, and they've asked everybody to light a candle in their window at 7 o'clock this evening. So we're going to do that, and David is going to be live streaming from home, leading some short prayers around 7 o'clock. So if you come back to this Facebook page about 5 to 7 tonight, David will be leading a short prayer from his house where he's isolated, and you'll need a candle. I don't know what we do if we haven't got candles in the house. You'll have to find something. Birthday cake candles, any kind of candle, something to burn in your window. Nick was talking about how we can support each other in our communities. We produced these cards, which say self-isolating, I'd love to help, with some suggestions of things you can do, and your name and your number. If you'd like, we've had ordered some from the printers to distribute this morning for her, but then the feds overtook us. We haven't got them. And we couldn't give them out anyway. But if you get an email into the office, email David, he'll email you the PDF of these, and you can print them out if you'd like to drop them around your neighbours. I know that some folk have set up little WhatsApp groups for their street, so that they can coordinate helping out other folk in their street. So there's some practical suggestions for things you can do there, the kind of things Nick was talking about. But also remembering that, be sensible and follow Martin Luther's advice. The other thing we've sent out this week is a PDF copy of our prayer calendar, prayer diary. If you haven't received one of these and you'd like it, it's got suggestions for each day for things to pray for, and also a whole list of all people who are part of the All Saints family, so you can pray for each other through the coming months. So if you'd like a copy of that, let us know, we'll email you one. I think that's everything. Is there anything else? Watch the Facebook feeds, but I think apart from that, farewell. God bless. Have a good week.